Welcome to this video. I feel really pumped up to do this one. I took a little break last night, a sort of Friday chill out session. Maybe I'll do that more often. You know, some music. We just kind of take it easy after a really intense week of practice, right? It's been a very intense week. We don't want to overdo it for anyone. We don't want to over. It's possible to do too much, actually. To try to do just like one video a day should be maximum, right? Don't do more than that. It's very intense, this new way practice of devaluing the I, which is really devaluing our belief in time, is super intense, super effective, but we have to respect this and realize that we've been given this so that we know it's there. But what I've been guided to right now is to take a step back from it. We know it's there. I've given like a almost 3-week trial to it and been extremely successful with it. I was able to experience my whole frame of reference shifting, momentarily shifting. I said, okay, this definitely does work. Okay, it definitely works. So we don't need to overdo it by any means. We should not overdo it. We take a step back and we develop more of a context and view. Basis and views, Tibetan Buddhism says, how they work is that first you have the breakthrough, and then you develop the basis and the view of that breakthrough, which enables you then to really have the breakthrough as something that's actually normal, stable, expected in your life, and then it no longer becomes a breakthrough, it becomes your actual experiencing all the while. So that's what we're headed for. Okay. Very gray. I'm going to bump up the light a little bit here. Yeah. So we have the spiritual practice now. We know it works. It's fabulous. I'm fine. But it is very, it requires a tremendous discipline and humility, actually. It requires a great humility. So I would say working on our humility is the key. It really is the key, because then we have to say, I'm not anything at all. I'm not anything at all. I am not anything whatsoever. I am absolutely no thing. Not nothing, but no thing. No thing. That we actually are able to not try to get this, but rather just allow it to permeate us and to have faith that there's a different frame of reference available to us. So the humility and faith are, I say, the two keys, the basis and the view. Humility is the basis and faith is the view that we need to cultivate for this frame of reference shift, okay, which we cannot get, we cannot understand the frame of reference shift in the old context. So we have to avoid trying to understand what it's about. Rather, we need to practice changing our expectations so it will happen. It will take place for us. And then we'll experience it. It's not what it's about. It's experiencing it that's important. It's the actual abiding in the experiencing of it, which is important. Not our understanding of it from the old context. Okay, from the old contextual frame of reference. So we're taking a little step back here, and I'm just sort of working into that. Very important to recognize humility. Now, what's been happening is a reinforcement has been happening with telling me to lay low, get out of the way, okay, right now, because I had an amazing meeting that just took place with someone driving down the street. A neighbor driving down the street, they stopped me, had a conversation. And the gist of it ended up saying, it was really extraordinary. He says, you know what, get out of the way. Get out of the way, because what's incoming into this world, it's basically saying, I don't want to hurt you, but I can, and I'm coming in, and if you're in the way, you're going to get smashed, for sure. So get out of the way is really the key component. Now Jesus, I say, is like my psychotherapist. He's like a therapist. So I go to Jesus and we have therapy. But Jesus never says anything to me. He's never said anything to me about the future of this world, what's the context of what's taking place in this world, issues, what you should do about it. Nothing. He's just working on recognizing that everyone's already awake, and we just have a false perspective. We decided to see if we could to perceive, to have a perspective, a false perspective on reality, so that we could imagine that reality could become abnormal, which means we could create a different reality, change reality and make it something different, and then we would be the prime creator and usurp the place of God. So, but everyone's awake. They just have a perspective as if they were sleeping, but they're not really sleeping. Not really sleeping. If you got a group of people and you ask them, okay, I want all of you to pretend that you're sleeping. You know, so everyone, you know, is pretending. And then you say, okay, how many of you are really sleeping? If you're really sleeping, raise your hand. Okay. Well, obviously, if anyone, whoever raises their hand, they're not sleeping either, right? Because otherwise, they wouldn't have heard you to raise their hand. So obviously, when you pretend asleep, you're not really asleep. You're not really asleep. So we're pretending to be asleep. We're pretending to be abnormal. We have this false perspective on what we are, but that doesn't change what we are. We still are what we are. We're still awake, as Jesus says. We're all awake. There's no, so you don't need to become awake. You already are awake. Everyone's awake. Enlightenment is not realizing that you're awake. It's realizing that all is awake. There's nobody that needs to awaken, actually. They just need to drop the false perspective that they're asleep. They've never been asleep. It's all pretend. It's all pretend. So you have Jesus working with me, my opportunity to work with him. It is working on issues like this. Okay, it's very. He gave out this new way practice. Super, 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 super great. Now, so that's his role. Now, Longchenpa is more like a business leader or the leader of a corporation or someone who is. Purpose is to long-term how to spread the Dharma, how to increase the Dharma, how to make it flourish. And so he has roles and responsibilities and stuff for you to do. So I have a working relationship with Longchenpa and then a therapeutic relationship with Jesus. Slightly different relationship, whereas Longchenpa seems to be addressing more of what is coming in the world, what we need to do to sidestep and all that kind of stuff, whereas Jesus is addressing the root of the shifting the frame of reference. Of course, Longchenpa also is emphasizing that, but he's more a hands-on, pragmatic, we're going to do this and this kind of, you get, you know, duties and responsibilities. He says, okay, do this, can you do this for me? So, for instance, traveling. The only times I've traveled really recently is Longchenpa asked me to travel. Would you go here for me? It's important that you go here. So he sets that up where I don't feel that Jesus is, my relationship with Jesus is not like that. It's just, you know, therapy, and we're going to focus just on this issue of awakening and how to devalue the I, etc. It's limited to that, which is great. So it's both very, very helpful. Now, the issue of traveling, I was driving today and I suddenly realized something very, very amazing. Very amazing. And the idea came to me, he says, what if it was such that only dignitaries should be allowed to travel? And I said, wow, you know what, I agree with that. Because I've virtually almost never traveled. Certainly I've been in the same place for like 54 years, I think now, and really have gone virtually nowhere. So I've just been, and I've been extremely successful with this. So I know that this is the recipe for success. Be very low, very humble, very poor, and don't travel. Stay in one place that you're familiar with so you can really, really focus in on the inner landscape. Okay, the inner landscape of what's really going on with your mind, instead of constantly being distracted by traveling. A lot of people these days travel constantly. It's unbelievable how much they travel. Unbelievable. I never go anywhere unless I'm asked to by Longchenpa. Now, If he asks me, I say, okay, because I'm working for him. So I'm a novice, but if you work for a Dharma king, then you're a Dharma prince, but I'm a novice Dharma prince, a novice. I'm just a novice Dharma prince, okay. But that does give me the right to travel because I'm working for a Dharma king. I'm Dharmic. So I have, I'm a novice dignitary, so to speak. Novice, but that gives me the right to travel. But prior to that, I didn't feel like I had the right to travel. I really feel like the right to travel should be a high honor, something that's earned through being part of Dharmic culture. Otherwise, I don't think people should have the right to travel. I really don't. And if you look at the world and all the mess that we're in, doesn't it have a lot to do with the modern age and people, you know, constantly going everywhere and burning up, you know, fuel and resources, et cetera, et cetera? You can live a very, very simple life if you just stay in the same place. Plus, you get your meditation, your contemplation, your Dharmic path will become much, much, much stronger and greater than if you're traveling around. Now, my dad, who traveled around the world all his whole life, hoping that would work, reported back to me at the end of his life and said it didn't work. And he says, it won't work. Believe me, trust me, this is not the way. And he says, you just stay where you are, and it's the inner path that's the one that works. And this is exactly what I've done. So I would certainly be open to this possibility that in a Dharmic culture that there's a travel ban. Absolutely, there's a travel ban. Now, in wartime, there's a travel ban. There oftentimes is. Only those who are, you know, rank officers, etc., who have a purpose that they're being ordered to travel, travel. Otherwise, no, everyone stays where they are and they work where they are. They're not gallivanting about on vacations, etc. Now, for the modern person, this may seem crazy, you know. But they'll say you need a shrink. Well, I got a shrink, the best in the business. Jesus, the one mind, the one self. So I can take that up with him. But I think that would be, it's a very intriguing idea. It's worth considering, isn't it? That there should be travel ban. That only those who are on Dharmic business should be allowed to travel. The rest of us need to anchor down where we are, bloom where we're planted, and actually begin to the discipline of daily practice, which is really does get supremely disrupted and distracted by traveling. It's very difficult, which is why I don't like to try to say, hey, I mean, I'd rather just stay here and grind it out and drop the pretense that I'm not awake and realize that everyone is actually awake. They're just pretending not to be. Now, I've experienced this directly. The times that I've dropped my pretense that I'm asleep, I realize that everyone is perfectly perfect. You know, everything's perfect. Everything's fine. But they're all kind of acting like they're asleep, even though I'm with them and they're not asleep. But they're pretending to. Imagine if you were someone. So there's someone who's standing next to you, and you were trying to talk with them, and you couldn't talk with them, converse with them. And look at us, say, what's wrong? I'm talking with you, and you're just like, you're standing there, and you're walking around even, but you're pretending you're asleep. That's what I experienced. It's like we're still functioning. We're just pretending that we're asleep. It's very weird. From a spiritual standpoint, that is what's going on. So when you have a travel ban, then what happens is Dharmic people can travel around, and the audience is there. Wherever they go, because the people would have like a temple or church or ashram or whatever, a meeting place, a spiritual meeting place. So when a representative of Dharmic culture comes, everybody is notified. There's a system of notification. The whole local community is notified in that area, and they're all at home. They're all practicing. They're all tuned in. They can all make it. They can all be there. Instead of nowadays, the scheduling is such that people are constantly going in and out. I mean, the circles that I'm travel through in my work, the people are more often not at home than at home. They're gone most of the time. It's just amazing how they're constantly in motion like that. Didn't used to be that way. I mean, one of the reasons why Tibetan Buddhism, I believe, has been probably the most successful Dharmic practice in history, with so many, 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 many liberated from the false perspective that of pretending of unawakeness, is because all the monasteries, all the teaching centers, and the people, populace, was there, was present. So if a teacher went somewhere, you know, everyone was in the monastery. There, they could teach everyone in the monastery, plus all the lay practitioners in the area. And there'd be thousands and thousands and thousands of people would come to see. And this happened constantly. So the people were continuously getting this tremendous boost from these Dharmic representatives. That's what it takes. Where right now, you don't know where anybody is. Okay. It's so difficult to get an assemblage, a consistent assemblage on demand where a Dharmic representative shows up. My friend told me that this Dharmic representative of Christianity was coming, giving a talk on the Holy Spirit. He says, you know, I'm attending. I mean, we're here and we're all going to go. But this is a rarity in a lot of ways these days as Dharmic culture breaks down. So wouldn't it be better if you stay in the same place for your whole life, and by doing so that you could go, like, you know, maybe 15 miles or 10 miles to this great assembly center near your place, and throughout your life you had contact with hundreds and hundreds of Dharmic representatives giving tremendous transmissions to you. And then you go back to your place of residence and practice for a year, you know, year after year, taking in and getting used to, familiar with what you heard. Wouldn't you rather do that than spend a lifetime of gallivanting around the world to resorts and sightseeing and taking pictures? I mean, those people who do that, I don't see any benefit they're really accruing, and I see a lot of very detrimental, actually. So it's this very, very low-key stay-at-home that has the most success. But in today's modern age, where are these Dharmic representatives? Last one I ever came upon was a Dalai Lama in San Jose in like 1986 or something. But it's not working. This culture is absolutely not working. It's a secular culture, and it's headed toward World War III. The first technological revolution brought World War I, second one brought World War II, now we're in the third one of artificial intelligence, and it's very likely to bring World War III. In fact, I believe it's a fait accompli. And so the question I'm looking at now is, how do you reconstitute culture after the meltdown? Okay, and the answer is Dharmic culture. And it's not going to be this gadflying, gallivanting, jump on a plane and, you know, go to Aruba and all this kind. It's not going to be like that. Because really, there is no world. Okay, there is no world to see. The more we keep reinforcing the notion there's a world, the more deluded we become. So for me, I don't even care about the world, because I don't care about going anywhere. Other than if I'm asked to. If Longchamp wants me to go on a retreat, then I'll welcome it, and I know it'll be a great retreat, and it'll be very sublime, which is fine. But other than that, I don't have any desire to go anywhere. Now, someone showed me this massive house, and I saw it. I said, you know, you couldn't pay me to stay there, because it's non-Dharmic. I don't feel it's Dharmic. I don't care what kind of mansion you have. If it's not Dharmic, you couldn't pay me to stay there. And you couldn't pay me to go to travel. If someone said, here's all this money, travel, I said, no. I'm doing great just where I am, doing fabulous, actually. I may be doing as well as anybody on anyone anywhere, quote unquote, in this world, which really isn't a world at all. That's a false perspective on reality. The false perspective on reality is the belief that there's a world, that there are worlds. Okay, that's a false view, very false viewpoint. There's really only the instant. It's just the holy instant is all there is, actually. And every instant is completely holy in and of itself, totally holy in and of itself. And there's no way we can understand this. You have to experience it. You have to experience it. That's why Jesus says, journey beyond words. You cannot understand reality at all. You cannot. So we all are trying to understand it, which is the great barrier that we have. And we have to get past that by this wow practice, where instead of, we have this breakthrough, instead of trying to understand it, we wow it. We block understanding of what we have just experienced. We block understanding of it. We just sit here in very simple, humble, I don't know anything mode. I don't know what to do about it. I don't know how to implement it. I don't know how to put it into context. I don't know how to understand. I don't know anything. I absolutely don't know anything at all for right now. But I do know the wow. Okay, that's it. I know just one thing. It's the wow. And I do that really, really well. Okay, I do that really well. So I'm not feeling, you know, completely out of sorts. But it's just one thing that I do well, which is the wow. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else. Last night, I had this dream where there was this some sort of band of orange, just brilliant, beautiful orange, and it was filling in. There were some parts that were sort of missing, and suddenly it all filled in to be to 100%. This orange band was 100% orange, perfect. And I realized I looked up, orange is a color of renunciation, spiritual color of renunciation, renouncing the world. So that means that's what I've been able to do. Spiritually, I've been able to renounce the world perfectly. That the practice I've been doing, de facto, beneath the surface, I've been able to renounce the notion that there's a world. So I've succeeded at that. So there's no world to understand. So there's no understanding of how do you overcome a world, because there isn't any world. There's never been a world. See, there's never been a world. So how can we understand a world? Trying to travel around people and say, I want to understand the world better. Well, that's the heart of delusion. It's the heart of delusion. To say, I want to understand the world better. There is no world to understand. That's very, very key. And of course, we don't understand that. How can understanding understand that there's nothing to understand? It says, okay, I understand there's nothing to understand. It's not possible. So we have to be lower than that. We have to humble ourselves lower than that and say, I don't know anything except the wow. The wow is all that I understand. I don't understand anything else. It's just the wow. That's it. And Jesus also says that you need to go beyond words. It says that asking questions, trying to understand, is intellectual curiosity. And really, he says, go to love or to peace, this feeling that there's no words arise, no thinking arises. He said, when you're like that, you're very close to the communication of reality, the true communication. That's why I say, Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma is helpful for me. Whenever I see her picture or think of her, all my thoughts cease. My attempts to understand anything cease. I don't need to understand anything. I already got it. It's here. I got it. Here's the presence. And I just go silent. I'm not the only one. Swami Chidananda. I read an article he wrote about Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma. He met her, I guess, a number of times. And what he says is exactly what I'm saying. It's amazing. And when he said, when he met her, it's just all questions, words, thoughts, everything just dissolved. And it was just in silence. It's just this presence, just the presence. She said it was just pure presence. Very helpful to practice that. I don't have any questions for her. I mean, to ask questions of her would seem to be the most ridiculous thing imaginable, really. So I would say Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma enables us to practice presence, okay? Enables us to get used to expect presence. So Jesus is my therapist. Longchamp is my boss. And Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma is my presence practice, right? Enabler of practicing presence. It's amazing how that works. It's just, you just feel it's so holy. She's so holy, perfectly holy. You don't want to try to disturb that holiness at all. Just let it be exactly as it is. Don't try to make any modification of it. And when you give up the desire to make any modification of some situation, you yourself feel presence. You see how this works? You yourself start feeling presence itself. Because our perspective, that our desire to modify presence, is our whole delusion, our false perspective. But when I come across, for instance, Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma, I don't want to modify her in any way. I accept her exactly as she is, with and no desire to modify her. I say, you're perfect. Absolutely perfect, just how you are. So I give up any notion of modification, and then when you do that, you go into silence. and presence and feeling love. And then you start getting used to that, more and more used to that. And this is really the true universal currency, the currency of reality. It's not words, it's not thinking, it's not understanding, it's not doing, it's not any of that. Because all is perfect. All is perfect. And so we need to begin to expect this and start practicing like I expect to feel this way. So I find this extremely helpful, more than trying to be quiet or still your thoughts or something. I've never been able to do that. I just said that's just not going to work well. Too much effort involved. But when I see a picture of Sri Sri Narayana or video or call it a mind, automatically it just induces this reverence of this homage, this reverence, this desire not to change anything. So much reverence, I don't want to change anything. I don't want to ask her to do anything. Just their mere presence is sufficient for me. Absolutely sufficient. That's all that I ask of you. Just your presence. And then, so this is super, super helpful. The thoughts fall away and all this falls away, right? It doesn't keep arising. But I'm a novice at this. I'm a novice Dharma prince, and I will be a novice for the rest of my life here, so to speak. And this is the right attitude to have. This is what we're talking about, humility. Is you're going to be a novice. Accept that you are a novice. Okay, you are simply a novice, and you, for the rest of your life, your entire life here, you will continue to be nothing more than a novice. That's the attitude I try to have. In spite of talking about the Dharma kings and all this wonderful clarity we have here, I still am just a novice. I see myself as a novice because in practical terms, it's exactly what I am. I'm a novice to the Dharma kings, but I'm still a novice, you see. A novice to the Dharma kings is higher than anyone in secular society. However, I'm still just this lowly, lowly novice. That's how I view myself and will continue to do so. Paradoxically, this opens up the door to the Dharma kings, so you don't get a big head and lose your mind and try to change the world or fix the world, you see. So fix the world. I'm just a lowest, lowest grunt, you know, novice. Very, very much the novice. And this man I talked to several days ago, he's so capable. He runs his business. The way he does stuff is just absolutely extraordinary. I don't know how he is so alert and constantly responding I said, you must have been some officer in the war. You're just so amazing how you managing all these people. And he says, no, I'm just a lowly grunt. That's all I am. Just a grunt. That's all I am. I said, wow. And that drove home to me, you can be extremely helpful, but still be this very, just lowly, I'm just a lowly, you know, the lowest rank. I'm the lowest rank. A Dharma prince, because I'm helping a Dharma king, but accepted by Dharma king, but the lowest rank of Dharma prince, so to speak, right? The very lowest, just a novice, just a novice. And those are the ones that are most reliable. They don't get in the way and interfere with what the Dharma kings are doing. They let them do that. We let them do their business, and we just say yes, you know, yes, sir. You know, you know, whatever you say. You want me to go somewhere? I'll go somewhere. You want me to stay here? I'll stay here. It's not up to me, you know, what I do or where I go. I'm happy to just stay right here where I am. I've had a lot of stuff blocked lately. Don't go there. Don't go there. So I stop. Stop. If they say it's enough, that's it. Then that's it. So I just feel like a lowly grunt means infantry man, lowest level of the military versus infantry grunt. That's all that I am. I'm just a lowly foot soldier, so to speak. the gap between a secular culture and Dharmic culture is unbridgeable. You cannot bridge it. It's impossible to bridge it. The Dharmic culture will forever be a mystery to secular culture, forever be a mystery to it. The only way to resolve this mystery is you have to choose Dharmic culture. You can never have both. You can never have both. Believing you can have both is secular culture. And we have a lot of that now. What secular culture does is tries to make itself feel righteous, self-righteous, by all sorts of trappings of religion, of Dharmic culture. It loves the trappings of Dharmic culture to try to make itself seem righteous. But this is what Jesus really criticized very severely 2,000 years ago, the Sadducees and Pharisees. He really put them, said, you know, they're the worst of the worst of the worst. They're terrible. They're the last to get in the kingdom of heaven, he said, the last. So that strategy I call spiritualization or spiritual materialism is really, you know, doomsday type of trend, which is what the world is really involved in right now. It thinks those of secular culture think they finally found a way to gain the right trappings of self-righteousness. So they say, we don't really need Dharmic culture. You know, we can do it because we understand it. We understand Dharmic culture. No, they don't. Dharmic culture cannot be understood. Cannot be understood. It has to be lived. Has to be lived. It's an entire different frame of reference than secular culture. Entire different frame of reference. So secular culture can never understand it. Will always be a mystery. But they keep trying to, you know, put on airs as if they got it. There's no getting of it. From the standpoint of a secular context, there's no getting it at all. That's why we keep reinforcing this. I can't get anything at all. I cannot get anything at all. Meaning that the time-based I belief, which is secular culture, can never get it. Anything at all. I can never get anything at all. I can never understand anything whatsoever. But this requires, you know, practicing humility, a basic orientation of humility. Like it's not me that's going to save the world. It's my job is to do what the Dharma kings tell me to do, and nothing more than that. They know what's best to be done. I don't. Okay, so I'll do what they tell me to do, and that way I'll be most helpful. It's really saving us from the preposterous notion there is a world. What a beautiful day. It's gotten cloudy. Very cloudy and cool. Big change in the weather here. Got my King Cobra hat on. And interesting symbology is the, you know, it means enlightenment, attainment, but also keeping it hidden. Keeping your talents largely hidden. They can come out in the open if needed, but mostly stay hidden and serve the Dharma kings and get prepared for a new Dharma culture down the road. Because this world here is again, I believe that World War III is certainly going to happen, and it's going to be, you know, vastly worse than World War II. Probably go nuclear at some point. And the world is going to take a long time to recover from that. But after the World War III, attitudes will probably change, especially toward technology, and say, wow, enough of this. Isn't there something better? We say, absolutely, Dharma culture. You don't need technology for Dharma culture, really. You don't really need it. If you have these ambassadors of Dharma culture traveling about, and you have audiences, stable audiences throughout the world, that, and you know, books of people, you get a great book like A Course in Miracles. You can spend 15 years just sitting in your room studying it, which is what I did. You don't need to go anywhere. I said, I'm not going anywhere. What I have here is more valuable than anything anywhere. What are we going to do? Travel somewhere, sightseeing? Oh, that's a nice mountain or something. Yeah. Are you kidding me? I have this amazing Dharmic book, A Course in Miracles. That's how I'm going to spend my time. So books can be written. Books. I like books better than e-books. I don't like e-books at all. I want something in my hand. I love it. I can set it right beside me like this. I can pick it up. It's there's something about flipping through the pages and going anywhere the way you do it like this. It's not dependent on electronics at all. Okay, it can't be lost the way electronics can be lost. It's just, I find books to be, you know, the way to go. I have them on my desk. I can pick it up, go through it like that. No distractions, you know. No crashed systems, no rebooting your computer, no screen you have to look at. You can underline stuff, dog your pages. It's just for me, it's a vastly superior way. And we're just trying to reinvent the wheel with all this, you know, electronic books and stuff like that, trying to reinvent the wheel. People can say, well, I'm traveling so much, I can keep all this on my thing. Well, you know what? You shouldn't be traveling so much, probably. And when you're not traveling, what do you need that for? You say, well, I need to carry all my books with me when I travel. No, if you're staying at home, you have a few books you need. You don't need so many books. You have them right there on your desk, or right by your bed. You read them before you go to bed. You read them when you get up in the morning. You read them throughout the day. That's what I've always done. They're right there. I just reach for it. Boom. Open it up. Instantly, I'm right reading it like that. Don't even need any batteries, do you? Don't need any batteries at all. You don't need to charge anything. You don't need to charge anything. You don't need to buy a new device when it breaks. Your device breaks. You can keep a book for 100 years, 500 years. Okay? Vastly superior system. So, we don't need this electronic infrastructure, actually, in a Dharmic culture. It's a great hindrance. People are so on the go, they're overloaded. I've got, you know, over 500, you know, Tibetan Buddhist books on my Kindle or something. Really? How about just having one and spending, like, you know, 8 hours a day immersed in it for the next 5 years? Oh, you know, I know I'm too busy for that, you know. I'll check my Facebook. I've got a blurb, like a sentence. Okay, that's enough. Good, got it. I'm off to the next, you know. Off to the next what? Very, very poor strategy. Very non-dharmic strategy. It's a very sectarian, self-righteous strategy. It says I can spiritualize myself and I can stay secular, but spiritualize myself. You can't. You cannot. Well, I've got 500 Tibetan Buddhist texts on my Kindle. So what? And I've got a million tankas, you know, or whatever. I've got this. I got, you know, access to all this stuff. I've spiritualized myself. So what? This guy has got nothing to do with the genuine a shift in your frame of reference, which has to take place. So it's not dharmic at all. That's spiritual materialism is the what's going on in today. What's going on? That's what's going on today. You know, so, oh, yogi, will you see me? You can travel. All this stuff, seminars, travel. It's unbelievable how much people are traveling. And the money you need to travel is insane. So they must have to buy into materialism to get the money to travel. I mean, I can't believe it. I mean, for me, the idea of getting on an airplane is almost unthinkable. I don't expect to ever be on an airplane. You know, if I need to go somewhere, I'll drive. I'm just not part of that culture at all, the travel culture. It seems to be failing drastically, drastic failure, actually. And yet everyone thinks that they're so advanced, so I can go all these places. I said, what? I'm going to some seminar. Well, you know, all the effort to pack, to go there, to check in. And they say, it's amazing. I look at these retreats and seminars that supposedly these gurus or whatever are giving. Whoever it claims to be giving, those who are giving them. And it's like, what? Yeah, we'll spend a little time, a couple hours here and a couple hours there. And there's time you'll be doing this and 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 enjoying this and wonderful meals and restaurants and da-da-da-da. I get that. I get that, you know, in the right context that can be accessible. But, you know, also, how about staying at home and reading a book that contains the wisdom, or doing the wow practice, which is even more profound, the combination of the two, and do that for 7 days, 10 hours a day. Give a full intensive like that, and I dare say you're going to be vastly better off than someone who spends 7 days in a retreat, traveling at least maybe 2 or 3 days out of that, you know, all the check-in, all the baggage, all the restaurants, all the chain, you know, going here, and getting maybe an hour or two of asking a few questions of a guru. It's like, guru, what can we do to fix the world? Okay. I mean, is that really the best use of time, doing it that way? I think it's, it seems like a very, very poor use of time here, quote-unquote time, our moments, as long as we believe in time, we will believe we're using it in some way. So how about using it in a way to recognize there's never been any time? In fact, time can't even exist at all. And the money for those seminars, holy cow. So instead of going where the gurus are and all this kind of stuff, you know, there should be like centers throughout the world, which is pretty much how Tibetan Buddhism sets things up, where and you stay where you are, and when the representatives going from these various centers come to the center, you know, you prepare for that, and you may prepare like, okay, they're coming in this month, so I need to do like 2 week-long intensives at my house, or in a local assemblage, like a local house or a sub-assemblage area, you know, where you focus 10 hours a day on studying and meditating the Dharma for a week at a time. So when the representative comes to the assembly area, you go there and you really, really, really tuned in to humility and the wow practice, wowing your success. You know, you're really, and then you're able to be and your presence is there. You're there as presence. You're there as presence, not some distracted traveler who's says, "Yeah, let me schedule an hour here for the guru, and then there's a bunch of sightseeing over there, and meeting people, and we're gonna have a tea ceremony. We'll bring it to tea, and we're gonna, you know, dress up this way. And then there's a concert here, and I'm gonna go sightseeing the next day, and then the guru here and go there. I mean, what is that? It's failure. It's secular." A spiritual materialism is what it is. It makes you feel good, like junk food, you know. It makes you feel like, hey, I don't really need to be that hermit. I don't have to live the hermit lifestyle. I can really gallivant and have a great secular time and indulge the senses. And wow, I mean, it's great. I can have the best of both worlds. No, you can't. No, you can't. That's a delusion. That's a severe delusion. Because in that way, you're not going to prepare properly to have your frame of reference completely shift to instantaneousness. You know, that cannot be explained or understood at all. And that you're just going to continue on the same old dreaming that you've been doing, but you just shuffle the deck in many infinite ways. You know, but it's the same deck of pretending that you're asleep. That you're abnormal, that you somehow keep working on inducing a change in reality. Still subject to all, you know, the illusory parameters of this attempt to induce abnormality, which is aging and death and vulnerability, you know, and everything you see it seems vulnerable to you, you know. It's horrible. It's hell. You stay in hell that way. But who among us in this culture is willing to live this life? I've lived it. I've lived the life of a hermit. And so, already done it. It is necessary. I realized, wow, this is necessary. Got a lot of help. You know, my health collapsed, which is very helpful. I couldn't work. I couldn't earn money. I couldn't travel. I couldn't do anything. So I can sit in a chair and study, can't I? Yeah. So like a hermit sitting in my room, in a chair for 15 years and continuing to this day. And the last 48 years has been pretty much a hermit. Even before that, I didn't go much of anywhere. I didn't really like traveling. I said, no, I'd rather sit in my room and study. Because I saw traveling as a distraction, as it was. It really broke up my focus very badly, and it still does. So if I get called to go somewhere, I really have to plan it for weeks and really make sure that it doesn't, you know, ruin my focus. But even, and I use the time properly where I go, if I go somewhere, that I use it to really, really, really propel dharmic breakthroughs. Not as easy to get caught up in the frivolity when you travel. Very, very easy to become superficial. It induces superficiality to a very profound extent. Now, boredom is great. I mean, am I bored here? Good. Focus on the inner landscape, the ideas that come from the Holy Spirit. So, the Holy Spirit is guiding me somewhere right now. It may take me somewhere and say, I want you to go there. Well, that's fine. But I make sure that the whole situation remains very much keyed into the dharmic context. Remain very serious about it. Very focused and very prayerful. And so the world's just not set up properly anymore for dharmic culture. It's just not set up. Some religions still have some of that. But like for me, there's no Dharma center that I could go to and say what I am saying right here. And I wouldn't want to invite anyone to travel any place at all. I feel that travel should really be restricted only to Dharmic representatives, dignitaries that are told to travel by the Dharma kings. And the rest should not travel. So that's the end of this globalization of everybody traveling everywhere and this mobility and all that stuff. Yeah, it would not be a mobile culture. Absolutely not. But it would be an enlightened culture. It would be a dharmic culture. So you can choose a mobile culture if you want, but you're also choosing hell along with that, I would say. Your perspective to be caught up in that and attracted to that and reinforcing expectations, which are really the prison bars, expectations. That's the deadly factor in all this, is expectations that form invisibly, and before you know it, you're in a prison of your expectations. So all this mobile stuff, don't need it. I don't have a smartphone, so I'm trying to make sure I'm not really dependent on electronics or mobile culture or any of that stuff. So I feel comfortable if I have to travel, I would. I could travel all over if I was called to do so. But I would only want to travel to those places and talk to the local people there in that area, so they could establish the strong community there. Okay. Right now, people are moving in and out constantly where I live. You don't even know who your neighbors are. How could you establish a strong Dharmic community under such conditions? It's ridiculous. It's utterly ridiculous. Floods of refugees going everywhere. And people, economic refugees of every type, or people trying to find something new, constant ferment and turmoil. This really undermines Dharmic culture. Dharmic culture is a situation where the people stay, generations stay in the same place, and your parents and grandparents got great transmissions from dark representatives. They brought you to great transmissions. The family, extended families involved, they all go together, right, to the assemblage place, the great ashram or something like that. And they talk about it amongst themselves. It's a topic of conversation. Their neighbors talk about it. They go with their neighbors. They know the whole community goes. So the whole community is vibrant, and they know how to greet one another. They know how to have a very sattvic lifestyle, right? And it's all reinforced by everybody you meet. But if there's constant motion and moving about, and all this materialistic people, seeking, greater and greater wealth by moving, on the hustling everywhere, it's just devastated Dharmic culture, just devastated. So I'm looking down the road. I don't see any way to fix it at this point. It has to collapse. The culture has to collapse, and out of the ashes of the collapse of this modern culture would then be a rise of Dharmic culture. And, you know, it would be simple. It would be easy and simple. You have a nice locale where you live in. You stay there. Your children stay there. You don't go away to college, okay? You don't leave the family and go away to college, so to speak, like that. The community grows from the center ashram, the center assemblage place. It grows out from that through the countryside, and everybody knows that. And so when dignitaries come, the attendance might be 100,000 people or something, or more than that. I mean, Longchamp's life, he came to a place and there were 100,000 people he was talking to or something. Yeah, there's no technology there. Word of mouth spreads like wildfire among a tight-knit community. People would send out flyers. They'd travel. There'd be, town criers used to be. People said, okay, this is the schedule, and I'm telling you, and a dignitary is coming. And that would be spread throughout the countryside. Everybody would know because they're looking for that. Say, what's that? What's the schedule? And the schedules would be posted everywhere. In the places of worship where they go, etc. And so people would know, and then they'd attend. Attendance would be, everyone would go for sure. They wouldn't miss it for the world. Vacations? What are you talking about vacation? That's better than any vacation. Are you kidding me? If you could take a vacation somewhere or go see like Jesus Christ coming to your local, your assemblage area, I mean, what are you going to do? Forget about vacations. So people have to really reconsider what kind of world they really want to live in. Do you really want to live in this secular, humanistic, spiritually materialistic world? Is that culture, is that really the best culture? I say it's probably the worst culture to live in, actually. And they try to hide that through all these perks and pampering, perks and pampering. Where I go to a gas station, they've got all new pumps, they're really, really, really slick. And it's like, wow, But then I put to pump the gas, I started, and this television's, there's this LCD screen, or LED, or LCD, some sort of screen, electronic screen, in the middle of each pump. And it turns on, and you have, what's it called? Station TV or something like that, gas station TV, or it's a service station television or something. It's a network where these service stations, they all have this feed, and you've got all this news, fashion, food, this stuff being pumped at you as you're pumping your gas. Is that a good thing? Very, very distracting. Very, very unwelcome. In Dharmic culture, often people, you don't need even cars. You could use bicycles or trains, or you could even walk or horses or something like that. Or you could walk to the assemblage place. It might be 5 miles away. You could walk 5 miles. That's a great pilgrimage. It's a wonderful, nothing, it's nothing for people in the culture to walk 5 miles. Or you could have horse-drawn carriages or something. You wouldn't need all this modern infrastructure that's destroying the ecosystem here. What's destroyed the ecosystem is science, plain and simple. Dharmic culture wouldn't destroy the ecosystem at all. We wouldn't have this massive infrastructure that we have to keep up, and the pillaging of all those materials that materialism requires. It's science that's destroyed the planet, folks, not religion at all. Just so they've got to. They're trying to blame religion for everything. It's science. That's all the inventions of science that have not only brought about the world wars, but brought about the ferocious pillaging of the resources of the earth. Okay, ferocious pollution of the earth, the massive population growth. All of that stuff comes from science. And people now devastatedly hooked on pharmaceuticals and drugs. That's science, 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 science. And they tried to market themselves like they made all these great advances. Not really. As far as Dharma culture goes, they've collapsed it. They haven't advanced it at all. They've almost destroyed it, along with almost destroying the earth. Dharmic culture lives in a very sustainable, super low carbon footprint type of situation. You don't even have cars. You don't have machinery hardly. Okay, you can have some simple stuff. It's fine. But you don't even have paved roads. You don't need all this infrastructure at all. You need an assembly place, and you need some books, and you need a simple house or simple hut, simple living quarters. People have been doing that for thousands of years very successfully. There might be a little different than what they've done in the past, but the overall gist of it is you don't need science. You don't really need science. There'll be a Dharmic science, okay, based on the Dharmic understanding, but not this materialistic science at all. There'll be a spiritual science, to how to live properly, etc., but not this coarse, crude, brutal, physical, materialistic science that we have now, that keeps trying to refine itself as if that's the answer. Just the throwaway culture, People use gourds, for instance. You keep gourds for, maybe hundreds of years, they would keep working. Just simple gourds from plants for store water, to do this, to do that. We wouldn't have all the plastic bottles being thrown away everywhere, polluting the oceans, would you? You'd have a gourd or some ceramic, something that you drink out of, and disposable water bottles, because everybody's constantly on the move and they're not around water sources. But if you live in a community, Dharmic community, there'll always be water for you. You don't have to have all these plastic water bottles. If you need water, you go to a neighbor's house, or there'll be a place to get water, or you have a gourd with you or something. I carry a thermos. I try never to use plastic water bottles. But traveling, you're constantly traveling, people bring them with them constantly to drink water as they travel, right? There again, traveling. Driving cars, everybody's driving cars. So things will be locally sourced, food, jobs, everything will be locally sourced in these communities the way it used to be. That's what's successful. We have gone on this very much a downward trip with science here in the world. And in experiencing this shift in a frame of reference, I know that science has nothing to do with that. There's not a trace of science once the frame of reference shifts, not a trace of it. Completely not needed at all. In this frame of when the frame of reference shifts to just instantaneousness, everything, you just materialization. I mean, not physical material. You could do materialize physically if you want to, but whatever you want, it's just your mind desires, this is what I want, and that's what you have in essence. And so there's no issues that we face in our false perspective. You don't need science to fix anything, to cure anything, not at all, not needed in the slightest bit. So this is a general trend. The details will work themselves out. Details will work themselves out, as they always do. But we're painting the basic outlines of a different culture. Absolutely. That's not Longchamp. I'm working with Longchamp on that. I'm not working with Jesus on that. He just has limited to what he talks to. Just this, drop the pretense that you're not awake. Which is really, he's working on this frame of reference shift. It says just concern yourself with that and nothing more than that. So this massive modern world built with so many materials, the amount of materials we use is completely obscene. It's absolutely obscene, this culture. But it does facilitate people being able to travel around all over the place. I'm going to flying in. Everybody's flying to Vegas. You know, everybody's they're moving, hustling, bustling. Airports just hustling and bustling everywhere. Driving every form of transportation. People are just frantically moving about the globe. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of places. I know people that have these maps in their house, and they put everywhere that where they've gone, and that's their goal. And they just have hundreds and hundreds of places that they've already gone in the world, and many more places to go. And yet they're ignorant of the Dharma, totally ignorant. They're thinking that it's something external to what they are, you know, and they need to find it. But that just uses so much resources to do that, doesn't it? Just think of how much money you need to be able to do that, and how did you get the money, okay? How did you get the money, right? Materials, selling stuff, you know, this whole infrastructure of business in the world, that's how they got the money. Whereas a Dharma culture, there's no business infrastructure in that way. It's not like a profit-based sort of infrastructure, really. It's not to become obscenely wealthy. You have enough to run your business. But you don't have this extra so I can go gallivanting about all over the place, right? No. You don't have the money to do that. You don't want the money to do that, actually. In Dharma culture, poverty is a great virtue. A great virtue. You say, I don't have the money to go anywhere. That's very virtuous. Very truly virtuous. Because I choose not to pursue, you know, worldly wealth. So the pursuit of worldliness is opposite to Dharmic culture, very, very opposite. And that's pretty much what most people in the world are doing. They're pursuing worldly wealth so they can pursue, you know, worldly experience, you might say. Yeah, it'd be nice to, you know, fly to Tahiti. You want to surf Tahiti, then fly to Costa Rica, then fly down. Let's go to South Africa, fly there, you know, and rent this. It seems like the world's your oyster, but really, it's much more dire to say, you know what? I got something better to do than chase waves around the world. Puts a heavy, heavy carbon footprint, and it's very distracting. You know, I'm constantly going through different cultures, which is very distracting. It's very difficult. If you're meeting people from all different cultures, this just creates a mishmash and a whirl in your mind of terminology. Everybody has different emphasis about terminology. You can't really use shorthand among the people you meet because they don't understand your shorthand. It dumbs everybody down, essentially. That this melting pot notion, it dumbs everyone down in the world. They don't come smarter, they come dumber. The real smart ones are those who have their own culture that's not a culture of constantly melting pot and traveling everywhere. So that everyone knows the shorthand, spiritual shorthand. So they can communicate very in-depth, very quickly, and their gestures, they just know, oh yeah, it's, you know, very, very good communication constantly taking place. When you're in a culture, like the Bay Area is one of the worst places in the world for that, constant influx of people from different places of the world who you know, they have no idea how to drive here, and they drive anyway, but you know, basically do is you kind of smile at one another and say, yeah, nice day today, huh? Yeah. And they kind of look like, I don't, you know, all the body language and cues are all different. So you really feel like a stranger, you don't know how to communicate. It's horrible, absolutely horrible. So you should not be going towards globalization, you know, one world culture kind of thing, which requires, you know, constant travel, the idea of traveling all the time. They're trying to institute that, but it's very superficial. I believe that culture spreads out through Dharma centers, is how it spreads out. And it gets anchored by communities that are stable, okay, and that everyone knows one another, they know what to expect, you know, and you know what your business is. So everyone is very, you know, super low crime, if like a zero, and people are meditating, they're studying, they're not putting on airs, you know, they're making progress. People, if you're quiet, people, and you know, like people in history wear the robes, ochre robe, you know, saffron robe, they're able to instantly know, okay, you're a member of this order, this is where you stand. Are you a member of the Dharmic cult, Dharmic dignitary, or are you serving them? And so people know where people stand in culture, their culture. They know how to relate to him properly, so it's smooth. Now, this may sound old school. It is. It's not old school. It's effective school. This is how you do it effectively. Effectivity never goes out of style. And what we've done is we've made it uncool to be effective. And we think it's trendy to be a failure, to fail. It's cool to be a failure. That's what I was taught growing up. This modern culture says, you know what, failing is like going to be really fun. Well, it wasn't fun. It wasn't fun at all. Opposite. It was horrible. It was miserable. Absolutely miserable. And so many people are miserable now. They have to take drugs to just pretend that they're not insanely miserable. Seriously. You start finding out about people and how many medications they're on, and you realize they're absolutely miserable, and drugs just are masking it. Because they want to be loyal to this failure culture we have right now. It's a failure culture we have right now. That's what everyone's into, failing. Failing to make the shift in their frame of reference, which would show that there is no way to sleep at all. There's no way to be asleep. It's impossible to be asleep. Totally impossible. And the health care would be so much better too. People would take care of their parents and their relatives in a much less stressful type of environment. What did Jesus say in Dialogue on Awakening? He said something about, in traditional culture, society, dementia, from all, the type of dementia certain type that we elders are having now, are unknown, unheard of, because they're still valued. He says when you stop valuing elders, they then go back in their mind to a time when they were valued, which isn't right now, you know. Therefore, their mind, they sort of short-circuit their whole perspective on where they are right now, and they live in the past, and therefore they have the short-term memory loss because they can't keep anything straight in the present moment because they're not valued in the present moment, and they're trying to seek, you know, where that when they were valued. So he says when elders are greatly valued in the traditional cultures, he says there's none of this short-term memory loss and dementia that was this epidemic in the world right now. The world is so epidemically inclined in every which direction right now, and yet we claim science is the answer, that this modern culture is the answer. No, it's the way to fail to realize. The way to glamorize failure is what it is. Science is a way to glamorize failure, actually. And then other scientists say, we need to colonize the moon and Mars, you know, we don't have enough space here, we need more resources, we need more science, you know, what is that? No, we need to not travel anywhere, stop traveling, become locally sourced in every which way we can, and have many assemblage places that are visited by Dharmic dignitaries. Just like I've laid out here. That's the answer. Not to go to Mars or the moon and mine those places, you know, to satisfy the insatiable appetite of science. And care for all the scientist-oriented people, care for them in insane asylums, really. Because it helped them, you know, decompress from their madness, actually. We don't want to send them, quarantine them someplace, because they'll wipe that place out too. create all the troubles that they have brought to this world. It's innumerable. If you really look at it, wow. The ferocity of the wars these days, who's really brought that? Science. The poison gases, you know, the bombing, everything. Sure, the wars in the past could be ferocious, but not like today. There was still some honor. Okay, mano a mano. Okay, like that, and it was very different. It was very, very, very different. Nowadays, you just get these stealth bombers, carpet bombing or something, or, get nuked. What is that? That's science. I mean, science. And the problem with nuclear reactors in this world is really, if the U.S. got hit by EMP pulse, if like a nuclear device exploded in the atmosphere, high in the atmosphere, like 300 miles in the atmosphere, and knocked out the electrical grid, guess what would happen? The nuclear reactors around the country, of which there are many, 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 go into meltdown. They'd melt down because they couldn't cool the fuel rods, right? That's what happened in Fukushima. Okay, the power got knocked out, and they overheated. The fuel rods went into meltdown mode and overheated. And so you could have all these nuclear reactors going into Chernobyl mode, and worse, all over the country. That's science has brought us nuclear technology. Not the Dharma. Okay, the Dharma said, don't do this stuff. That's a road to hell. Dharma culture realizes that this is all possible. But just because it's possible doesn't mean you should do it. They say that this is very, very bad. Very, very, it's gonna end very badly. So, when we talk about World War III, you're talking about EMP devices for sure. Okay, if World War III were to happen, I believe it will. The deadliest devices is EMP devices, because that knocks out your electrical grid. It can knock out all your electronics. And failure of nuclear reactors, failure of culture to function at all, right? So it's not going to be just, a couple of knights, jousting or something. Or in the old days, like in the ancient cultures, they'd each side would choose a champion, and the two champions would fight, and the loser, the side of the loser would then be, basically in bondage to the winning side. But the winning side would say, okay, but now we now are administrating your land. But we want you to stay right where you are and keep working there, work the land, and be peaceful and prosperous. But we're administrating it like that. So no destruction of infrastructure, that kind of stuff. That's, ideal. That's much more sane, isn't it, than what we have right now. The upcoming war, a lot of, electronic espionage, a lot of crashing computer systems. It's all about electronics, crashing the electronic structure of culture to wipe it out. It makes it very vulnerable. Culture is super vulnerable in that way. Amazing, right? The scenario that's going on here. All of this was foreseen, saying this is, the wrong way to go. We've gone down the wrong trail in this world. Very much so. Do we have enough Dharmic representatives to help everybody out? Maybe not at this point. So maybe it would have to start out the best way it can start out. I know Papa Sava came in and taught his 25 close devotees, and then they taught many more, and so through generation to generation, more, and that way enabled then the monasteries to have, Dharmic dignitaries teaching there and some traveling around, and was able to, through the hundreds of years, able to spread out and become very, 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 very robust. But it might take a while to establish a Dharmic culture here after the meltdown of this world. Because there may not be sufficient numbers of Dharmic dignitaries traveling about and teaching in monasteries, etc. The staffing might be an initial problem, but so it would we'd have to work on building that up. We'd look at the past as like that was a bad affair, a bad affair. Had an affair with technology. Really bad. Really bad. Not interested in that anymore. I'm done with that. It's all in the mind. Everything is a mental projection. This has been known and known and known and known. There's no excuse for us to pretend like, oh, we didn't know that. I mean, how could you expect us? I mean, that's always been taught. That's always been the case. What do you think Buddha taught, for instance? The truth doesn't change. This is all a mental projection. There's a dreamlike mental projection, pretending. This is a false perspective on reality, is what it is. It's a hallucination. So what we are think we're seeing is a hallucination. We think we're seeing a world, that's a hallucination. There is an appearance, there's just all this decoration, but it's not a world. It's just the holy instant. There's only the holy instant, which means nothing to secular expectations. And they say, I can't figure out how to co-opt that, you know. You gotta make it co-optable for me. Yeah. No, we don't. You're a, you know, just a, the your assemblage place will have the books for you. Those will be distributed. You go there. If you can't afford it, you probably get it for free. So you have the right books to study. You have the right telling you how to practice properly. And you just keep your nose to the grindstone, decade after decade after decade, and gradually you become, you know, wiser and wiser and wiser, and feel more and more and more part of success. You know, you feel like, wow, this really is working for me. Which is what we're really after. The secular culture, the false perspective on reality will never satisfy us. We'll always be fear-based. Always be fear-based. Always feel unstable and vulnerable. Never satisfy us. Never, ever satisfy us. So, what we really want to do is get more and more comfortable with our expectations that we're going to gently set down this false perspective. That's all we need to do, is get more and more expectant that we're going to gently set down this false perspective of reality. That's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. Nothing more than that. We don't need to see what we can do with this world, how many products we can produce, how many different types of food we can produce, how exotic this or exotic that, or how many paintings we can paint or music we can make. We don't need to do any of that. All we need to do is become more and more and more expectant that we are going to gently set down our false perspective on reality. That is it. And the glory that we experience when we do that, nothing can be said about it in worldly terms at all, in hallucinatory terms at all. It's, and we shouldn't even try, but let's just say that, you know, it's worth doing, to say the least. So the world war, is it coming? I've certainly been shown it's coming. I've always believed it will come. And it's certainly getting more and more close in terms of breaking out physically. Psychologically, the world war has been going on since 2001, you might say, very severely. Before that, it was certainly a lot was going on, but it's gotten worse and worse. So there's definitely been very severe, maybe 1997, actually, you might say, is when it really, really started getting bad. There's been this severe psychological war taking place. Quote-unquote, in this world. And eventually that psychological warfare spills into different other types of more physical, more crude type of warfare. But there's just been a ferocious battle, a psychological battle taking place. And so at some point, that'll then spill over to actual, you know, physical combat involving, you know, loss of body life and the stuff like that. But the loss of your clarity is much more catastrophic than the loss of a physical body. Jesus says, don't fear those who can cause, you know, bring about the loss of your body. Fear those who can bring about loss of your clarity. That's the danger, really. Because when you lose that, how do you correct the ship? You know, you don't know which side's up, which side's down. You keep miscorrecting it. If you think up is down and down is up, you miscorrect it. You think, oh, okay, good, I'm upside down. That's it. I got it. I got to stabilize here. And you can't stabilize it. You know, it's just because our normality is right side up. Right? So we're always inherently that. And it's difficult to keep pretending that you're asleep. Yeah, it's very difficult. So the those who are may carry things forward to physical warfare are pretty much on the stage already. Before it was psychological warfare, which is of course worse. Physical warfare is actually somewhat a relief from the psychological warfare. Really, it's actually sort of a period of actually finally, you know how like sometimes a fever gets a lot worse when it's about ready to break or something? You might get really, really sick, and the fever suddenly spikes, and then fever breaks, and then you realize, oh, the illness is over. I'm going to recover. It's sort of like that. So the physical warfare in World War III is will actually be the end of the sickness of this world, of this phase, and trending towards a recovery. Whereas these times right now, the illness is raging, psychological illness is raging terribly. It has really been raging throughout my entire life. It certainly got worse and worse and worse as each decade, that is for sure. It's 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, you know, 2000s, and 2010s. Now it's worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. So we're devastated psychologically right now, the world. Very, very sick. I mean, I see people walking around, and I would say, if you're seeing t-shirts, I just noticed none of them are Dharmic, and most of them have skulls or some death symbol on them these days. Most of them, reflecting the state of mind of those who have that, violent themes, death themes, real bizarrely perverse themes, stuff like that. This is their psychological state. So the psychological war has been absolutely ferocious, and I believe the boomers have repented, have decided to repent. This is a dream I was shown, and they're going to be the ones that are reincarnated into a Dharmic culture, okay? A lot of them will. That's what I see happening. And they indicated to me that they're willing to read, meaning they're willing to settle down in one place and start reading and start studying and work trend towards being really Dharmic. They realize that's what we have to do. This world right now, that's not it. That's not the answer at all. So the boomer generation will be leaving this world pretty soon, a lot of them, right? I mean, they're you know, getting older right now. I mean, most of them are 60, over 60 for sure. The younger ones are over 60. The other ones, if you go way back to, if you want, well, you start 45, you know, they're starting in their 70s at this point, actually. And a lot of them started dying in their late 50s. And so the dying is happening to the boomers. They know they're headed that direction. And so they will, you know, be phased out of this world and will probably reincarnate in the reformed world in terms of a Dharmic culture, if that's going to take place on this planet. And they indicated that they're willing to settle down and start studying. And yeah, that works. That absolutely works. So I may be able to help them because I know it works. You see, so I'm very confident that it works. If I prove it to myself that it works, so they'll want to know, did you do it? Did it work for you? I said, yeah, I did it, and it worked for me. When did you do it? Back, pre-war times. And they say, what? How'd you do that? That's amazing. We were all so distracted. And I say, well, it wasn't easy. That's for sure, it wasn't easy. So that's my perspective. I feel definitely that the world is going to go to ashes, so to speak, and out of the ashes, like a phoenix, we are aiming for a Dharmic culture to arise, and then those who have decided to commit to that will reincarnate there in some fashion and show up. I don't know if they'll materialize or how it'll work out. And they'll get down to business, and they will succeed. They will succeed. Because when you get down to business, you will succeed. If it's your purpose to succeed, you will. So I believe this this whole boomer generation and those flirting with spirituality and all this is a precursor. They were setting themselves up for their next life. They were kind of checking it out, like kind of window shopping, right? Kind of window shopping, like, or going to a store, like you're not really buying, but you're kind of checking the cars out. Go to a car dealership and check the cars out and say, yeah, I really like this. And suddenly you realize in the back of your mind, say, okay, I'm not quite ready to buy yet, but I kind of know what I want to get. It's like that, window shopping, but they got to get a good idea of what they want. So their next life, they're going to say, okay, let's go all in here. Let's go all in. If the women don't go all in, then being the heart of the family, then nobody's going to go all in. You see, in my dream of boomers, it was the women, boomer women decided that they were going to choose Dharmic culture, and they said, "Okay, we're gonna read. We're gonna read. Meaning, we're going to grow a culture that is more intent on study and reading, in a stable environment, and really focusing on." Getting familiar with what we need to get familiar with. That's what the dream was. It indicated that. And when I saw that the women are willing to do it, I said, okay, that's going to happen then. Because they're the ones who raise the children, they're the heart of the family, and if they're not Dharmic, how can they help raise Dharmic children? There's going to be a lot of conflict. If the children coming in are Dharmic, there'd be terrible conflict and difficulty. But if they're committed to a Dharmic culture, then Dharmic children can come in to the family, and things will run much more smoothly. I was buying. I was getting something, some lunch for someone, and in a store. And there's all these young people that they staff the store. It's a bustling place. I just look at everybody about me, their body language, and just read in their Dharmic, their sattvic, rajasic, tasmic kind of their whole vibe, right? Just read in everything, swear. And those who were like doing a lot of work were some young women. And I was just waiting for my order. They'd pick it up, and there was a couple of them were serving. One of them was a certain way, and I said, she's not Dharmic at all. She's very modernistic, and like almost all of them. And there's this other one came on the scene. You look at their hair. You notice this stuff. There's a sattvic way of living. That helps you out a lot. And most modern women are oblivious to this and do just the opposite. And it really messes them up bad, very bad, because women are very sensitive and impressionable, very rajistic and exuberant. And if they get messed up, they get really messed up, really bad, go really rotten. So they have to take a lot of care to not go bad, really, they do. So this other young woman showed up. She was also giving out orders, apparently. And immediately I noticed she's different. I said, different, very different vibe. Just the way she presented was a very different vibe. I said, huh, this one actually has some potential. You know, they're doing something right. They're being raised in the right way. Maybe very traditional. I don't know, maybe she was, I don't know what culture she was. It's hard to tell you about every culture in the world here. I said, this is, maybe she raised in a very traditional culture because she's aware of her vulnerability, her sensitivity, and how to minimize, you know, getting messed up some way. And her movements are calm. She wasn't all kind of over exuberant, smooth, calm, relaxed, just sort of peaceful and quiet, sort of in mind. Her mind could tell it was sort of peaceful and quiet. I said, it's very unusual. It's very, very unusual. I said, wow, rarely do you see this these days. And then she ended up being the one handed me my order, says, here you go. And so usually I don't pay any attention. I just take some thanks, you know, thank you and have a nice day and go. But this time I just sort of said, oh, thank you. And I sort of smiled, looked at her and smiled, looked her in the eye and smiled. And her eyes look right into mine. They're quiet, peaceful, quiet eyes. And look straight into my eyes. It's like, ah, well, who am I looking at here? Someone's actually looking at me. An older person's actually looking at me. And it's like a quiet, this quiet look, you know. It's like, it rarely, I mean, it's very rare. Very rare. I said, wow, what is that? She had like a quiet mind. And she somehow, she looked into my eyes, which is super rare. She must have felt this. Who is this? You know, who is this? Because I kind of sort of bowed and I took it and I looked at her like, you know, because I sort of was like acknowledging her dharmic qualities like that, you know. And she must have felt that I was like acknowledging some her spiritual dharmic qualities. And then she like was acknowledging like, wow, thank you for acknowledging. Like it's like, huh. I said, okay, so that's how it is in dharmic culture. That's how it is. Generations can look at each other, older people, younger people, and if you're dharmic, you're beyond all that superficiality, you know, and you recognize it. So maybe she felt that, like, hey, here's someone who's recognizing my dharmic qualities here. How rare is that? Very rare. It wasn't like a techie person. There's all these techie people around. You can tell the techie people are so messed up, probably on so many medications. They're so messed up. Their hair's all chopped up, you know. She had her hair very, very nicely in a bun, very sleek, slick back in a bun, very neat like this. And there was no aberrational jaggedness, you know, going on in the psyche there. I said, rarely do you ever see that these days. And you could see that she'd probably be able to just like sit quietly and have no desire to go anywhere. She was content just to sit very quietly, very dharmic. Where everybody else was laughing and active, like, I'm on the move, I'm going places. You know, this whole energy, like, I'm constantly going places. I'm on the move, I'm upwardly mobile, I'm successful, I'm the world is my oyster, I'm getting this and this. She didn't have any of that feeling there at all. Now, who's, you know, is all you say, oh, she doesn't have the get up and go, the ambition. So, good, you know, may have the ambition to drop the false perspective that being unawake is possible. May have that ambition, which is the only genuine only ambition that pays off at all. Some old lady in a wheelchair was coming out. I opened up the door and the people around her were so thankful. Thank you so much for helping, you know, respecting your elders like that. They're elder people, you know, very appreciative. They're very kind of like, hey, you know, so not all young people are non-dharmic. Okay, there may be some that are dharmic, right? It's possible. People just may overlook them. Their face was not made up at all. It was completely natural. It's total, very natural self-forgetfulness there, kind of. The eyes were just open, like an open mind. No cleverness. I didn't see any cleverness there. It was an honest, like an honest childlike look of just like that. It's like, wow, how is that possible these days? So, you know, there may be some coming into the world who are going to help out. Women are especially important for Dharma culture, again, because they're the hub of the family, of the community. And if they go bad, the whole community goes bad, which is what's happened in the modern world, for sure. For sure. It's a Cinderella. You know, people feel sorry for Cinderella. She's just in one place. She's stuck here. She's doing the lowly work and everything. But Prince Charming comes along, which really, you know what Prince Charming is? It's the shift of your reference frame. It's your reference frame shifting. That's Prince Charming. So to whom does this reference frame shift come to? It comes to Cinderella. Okay. So women should be like, we should all be like Cinderella. Okay. We should all be like Cinderella. And I am. I'm definitely Cinderella. You know, doing very low, menial labor. Not having really any disposable income at all. I have to, you know, basically get help from people. Okay, you know, if I want to do something, can I have $20 or something? And people, you know, family does help out a little bit, right? But, so it's not like I'm destitute. I have to keep up appearances here. But having you know, like doing the lowly menial labor that Cinderella had to do, having everybody else lorded over me like they're superior, they're going here, they're going there, doing all this kind of stuff. I'm just stuck, you know, cleaning out the ashes from the fireplace and cleaning the house and dusting out this, you know, the lowly menial work. You know, and the other ones living in, you know, finery and palaces, mansions, big houses, doing all this, you know, all cars, all this stuff, finery. They hope, oh, I hope I get the goodies, you know, because I'm self-righteously good. But all the while Cinderella is contemplating and practicing the wow practice and practicing devaluing the I and staying very humble. And then one day, the prince of the reference frame shift comes by and he says, hey, I'm coming to this house. And the stepdaughter says, oh, great, I'm sure the prince is coming to see me. I'm going to be the one. And he says, Cinderella, you're the one. You know, you're the one. You're going to the ball with me, so to speak. Yeah. What? People are like, look, this nobody, she doesn't even know the world. She's never gone anywhere. What are you talking about? We've traveled everywhere. You know, we've taken all this transportation. We've met all the people of the world. We're worldly sophisticated. Cinderella, she's never been anywhere. All she's been is just in this little house cleaning, you know, doing the menial tasks like a maid. And she had no education, nothing. What are you talking about? She's nobody. She's nothing. Prince, you're making a huge mistake. We're sophisticates. Come on. He says, no. She prepared herself for the reference frame shift. And I, Prince, am the reference frame shift. You see? That's how it works, folks. That's how it works. If I put some sunglasses on this hat, I could look pretty hip, couldn't I? Absolutely. If I needed to look hip, just put some sunglasses up there. Of course, question is, what am I doing with sunglasses on my hat when I wear glasses? So, absolutely Cinderella should be the ideal. Absolutely Cinderella should be the ideal. and those women are like Cinderella. They're vastly more dharmic, you know, than the ones who are trying to be sophisticated. I'll tell you that. Their mind is so much more peaceful. They're so much wiser. They can listen. They can hear. They can absorb because they're used to letting it sink in. They've lived a simple life, and they've maximized their time here. Maximized their time. Patience, the virtues, you know, they've practiced the virtues. Virtues are not something to intellectually grasp. They're something to practice in your life, to live. There's something, virtues are to be lived. Virtues are to be lived. So the disease of sophistication is really just, a horrible plague of this planet. Too much information. There's a disease of sophistication. Everyone wants to be sophisticated. Instead of realized. You know? They think that being sophisticated will result in a realization. What they're really after is they think it will induce a change in reality and they'll be, you know, the new prime creators. And then they'll say, I decree that I'm happy. Everything, right? It doesn't work that way. So, sophistication will not bring happiness at all. Not Sri Sri Nanamayama, super unsophisticated. Didn't know how to read or write. If you asked her where she traveled, she said, I've never been anywhere. She grew up doing menial tasks. Householder life. Cleaning, cooking, weaving. You know, all the female responsibilities in a traditional culture like that. That's how she grew up. Scrubbing the floors, doing all the hard, you know, work, all that kind of stuff. Didn't go to school. Okay, no education to speak of at all. She went, I think, kindergarten, first grade, and she paid no. She just, the teacher said she's not interested. She's retarded. She's in a world of her own. She's just in a world of her own. It's useless, you know. So it just stop. Cinderella. Here she is, Cinderella. Except she's the archetype of Cinderella because she didn't need any reference frame shifts and she never pretended to be unawake, that being unawake was possible, that being asleep was possible. She never had the viewpoint that an absence of awakeness was possible. But lived a life like Cinderella. So humble, very humble, subservient, humble, lowly, you know, I'm nobody special at all. If people come to see her, she says, well, I'm nobody at all. Why come to see me? He says, well, we really like, love your presence. Can we stay here for a while? She goes, well, ask my husband. I said, okay. He said, yeah, okay. She says, okay, I don't ask you to come see me. I don't ask you to go. We'll just follow the social rules and regulations the best we can. Didn't big time the world because there was no, in her view, there's no world to big time. Didn't big time people because there's no people to big time, actually. People are just a notion that An absence of awakeness is possible. She said, I only see perfection everywhere. There's only God, and I only see perfection everywhere. That's it. Because where's there room in instantaneousness for imperfection? Every instant is perfect. In itself, in its holiness. Every instant is perfect in its holiness. That's reality. Ireland used to be, fairly Dharmic, very, very Catholic. A lot of priests came from Ireland, and they got disrupted by certainly the, you might think, oh well, being simple people causes famine and everyone dies. No, that's not true, because it's really let's be honest, what happened there. It is the ownership of Ireland being English. I think, was it Cromwell, I believe. They took over the land, and then turned all the land over to pasturage for sheep, so they could eat mutton and have wool and all this stuff. They turned into a big plantation, and the Irish were not allowed to own land, and they could, the most they could have was a little plot, a little tiny plot somewhere, maybe stuck behind their shanty or something, and pretty much they realized the only way we can survive is to grow potatoes. So everybody planted potatoes and relied on potatoes. They didn't have the rights to grow, other food, really, that was easily, the amount of space they had. The whole country turned to just eating potatoes. But there was only one variety of potato that was planted there. And then a blight struck that variety of potato blight. And killed all the potato plants, and so they didn't have anything to eat. Could they eat the mutton? No, that was sent over to England. Ireland was just a plantation, and so yeah, they had a hideous famine, and caused many Irish to come over to the United States. My grandfather, being pure Irish on one side. Yeah, they had to flee the potato famine if they wanted to live. I don't know, but did Dharmic culture cause that? You have to ask yourself. No. I would say non-Dharmic culture caused it, brought that about. The empire building, British Empire, very non-Dharmic culture, you might say. And very into corporations and building mass and great worldly wealth and power and prestige and all of that stuff. And so they just said, Ireland is just some land that we can grow our mutton, sheep on. Yeah, people, they don't eat much. The Irish, they're simple people. That's just they didn't eat much, but the potato blight, came along. So if things have been different, they would have had much more of a greater variety of food, you might say, right? They'd been able to farm their own land, and it wouldn't have been nearly the trouble. So the idea that a simple lifestyle is somehow going to cause famine for everybody is really ridiculous. Again, in India, some of the terrible famines in India were the result of the East Indian Company, which is a British company, a corporation, the world's first super mega corporation. Again, turning all the arable land of people into simply cash crops. A lot of it was opium to sell to the Chinese and get them addicted. And the people starved to death. They had all these rules and regulations, and they collected all the food to sell for themselves, and massive famines throughout the land. So many millions of people died. Really, really devastating stuff. Largely because of the greed of these secular materialists. You know, we own the land, we are ministry, so you grow the crops that we tell you to grow, and so we can ship them to some other country. Yeah, but what about the crops we need to live? I said, well, you can take a, you know, have a little bit for yourself, but well, what if the drought comes and, you know, we haven't stored enough grain? Oh, oops. You know, oops. Well, I guess you're out of luck. Well, that's what happened. I mean, weather patterns, you don't always have bumper crops, and you run into a, you know, bad stretch of weather, and you've been growing all your crop, turned all your land into opium poppy land, and where's your rice then? Oops, don't have any. So it's materialistic greed. I mean, let alone trying to get everyone addicted to opium so you'd make massive amounts of profit. I mean, that's just you know, unconscionable non-dharmic activity. And that continues on pretty much of let's get everyone addicted to video games. I mean, people, video game industry have told me, you know, that's their goal, is to get you addicted to electronics, video games. A friend of mine says that their relative can't sleep, doesn't eat, doesn't sleep, got super sick, hospitalized. Why? Playing video games all night. They're completely addicted. And the whole gaming industry, but the whole tech industry, they're experts in addiction, how to get you addicted. They're very, very focused on that. That's their goal. I mean, to someone who's dharmic, that's unthinkable. You know, so it's very difficult to deal with this culture and people, because you can't. It's really hard to understand them, because you can't believe anyone could be like this. You know, you cannot believe it. Our goal is to make sure you don't get addicted. But their goal is just addiction. They're just flat out playing it simple. Yeah, got to get addicted. Got to turn everyone into robots. So that our pretending to be asleep, you know, becomes automatic. They're trying to distract their mind such that the attention can't settle and realize, hey, wait a minute. Am I really asleep, or am I just pretending to be asleep? Right? Is sleep possible, or is it impossible? I mean, is this spiritual sleep really possible, or is it really just a viewpoint and not a fact? They want to prevent their attention from turning in that sort of contemplation and consideration and pondering. So keep you constantly addicted, frantically addicted to action, video games, action, 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 like this, like that. It's all on purpose. It's all part of a blueprint here. To turn this world actually into a plantation. You talk about the British Empire turning Ireland into a plantation. There's a cosmic corporate empire that is intent on turning this planet, quote unquote, dream planet, it's a mental projection, but turning this planet into a plantation for them, and will be treated as rudely as the Irish were, that's for sure. And what's the crop they want to grow in this world? Fear, agitation. Addiction to sensation. That's the crop that they're growing here on this planet. Mental disturbance that gives them a feeling of empowerment. They believe, you know, it's something that makes them feel that they exist, you might say. So again, this planet, there's an attempt to turn this planet into a plantation. Okay, and to make you slaves on that plantation, like the Irish, they had the little shanty shacks with, you know, just no way to repair them. I mean, they lived in someone told me, a traveler there, that said that they'd never seen any people more destitute than the Irish in their living conditions. It was truly horrific. And my ancestors came from that. Some of my ancestors came from that. So you can understand that this gets your attention, doesn't it? The only way out was to be a priest, really, and then be sent out of Ireland, a lot of them, right, throughout the world. That's why you got Irish priests throughout the world. That's the way they survived, pretty much. The rest of the people either died or they immigrated to America, basically, somewhere, but a lot of Irish came here. And of course, to kill the misery, they made, you know, alcohol out of the potatoes. Or whatever they could make alcohol out of, and they'd drink themselves to sleep at night because they were freezing. Ireland doesn't get that cold, but they're cold and they're miserable, and their house is full of holes and drafts, and you know they live in a terrible life. But the ones that own the land over there, like, you know, Prince of the Realm, you know, they have it living up, eating their mutton stews, and are so wealthy and happier, and, you know. The pigs. So that most certainly happens is we know in colonialism that essentially the colonial powers made plantations out of the places they conquered, plain and simple. Did they not? Of course they did. Absolutely they did. They were simply plantations. The people there were slaves on the plantations. The wealth all went to the colonial power. It did not go to the people there. They just kept them on pretty much starvation wages, really. And all the stuff, you know, they took out of there, what you name it, right? All the materials. The natural resources, all the natural resources were put into, you know, aggrandizing, you know, the lives of the colonial powers, the lives of the people there, the shareholders, really, of the corporations. And their families, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? The bourgeois, shareholders of all these corporations. So that pattern is repeated throughout the cosmos, and that there is most definitely cosmic corporations, and their goal most definitely is to make this world a plantation. And you can see it's completely obvious if you're Dharmic. You can absolutely see that they're pulling everybody down into out of sattvic dharmic type of focus into rajistic tamistic type of focus, which is fighting and belligerency and easy to stir up, you know, hatred and lust and fear and paranoia and all this stuff, which is a certain vibration that these colonial corporate powers, that's what they want. They feed off of it. It's like food to them. It's a vibrational food for them. Like a power source for them, actually. It's a power source for them. It's like electricity. We use electricity. They use human emotion as a power source. So they want us to be very emotionalized, which is a rajistic culture, is that way. And, of course, they subverted this world by telling women who are naturally more rajistic than men that the sattvic society suppresses their natural inclinations, which is to be very exuberant and, whoa, let's party, let's, you know, this is fun, let's, very exuberant and, you know, rajistic. We have those women being very self-contained, you know, Victorian era, very self-contained, very, very sattvic, trying to, you know, pursue their salvation. And these colonial, corporate colonial colonialists coming to enslave this, turn this world into a plantation with enslaving us. They want that power source of emotion. So they told the women, oh, you were repressed, you know. Women's liberation was really these colonialists, corporate colonialists, to subverting this world, to pull this world out of a more sattvic orientation, or gentle, the virtues, okay? And the women passing on these virtues to their family. They approach the women and say, hey, you know, you could be having fun, you know. You could be drinking and dancing and gambling and whoring and dressing up fancy fashions and going out to restaurants. I mean, you should be more, you know, rajistic, you know, your natural inclinations, you know. If it feels good, do it, you know, that kind of thing. And so they subverted the women, convince, you know, because that's kind of their norm. Go back to the normal structure of femininity here, is that way. The creatureness of it. And it's a lot of work for women to cut that off, you know, and prevent that influence on their lives and become more sattvic. They have to really work at it. And so these colonialists said, hey, corporate colonialists, cosmic corporate colonialists said, that's a lot of work, you know, it's not fair. It's easier for the men, you know, they're more sattvic. You have to work harder. That's not fair to you, you know. And they're just trying to prevent you from having a good time. They're repressing your natural urges of the id, you know, your animal urges. They're repressing that. It's not fair to you. You're not enjoying life, you know. You should get out there and have a good time and look at all these fashions you could be using and make yourself more attractive and glamorous and stuff. And so they subverted sattvic culture, Dharmic culture here among the women, okay. And then when the women are subverted, then everybody goes. So it's subverted basically. And it was easy. It's always easy to tell Eve, like, hey, you know, it's they're making you work too hard, Eve. You know, to be sattvic. You know, go back to your natural animalistic inclinations. You'll be much happier that way. Easier life, fun. We'll bring, and in exchange, we'll bring all the scientific innovation here. You'll have all this wonderful materialistic stuff, make you even life even more fun. And that's what they did. So then what happens is then Eve becomes very emotionalistic instead of self-contained, sattvic, calm, peaceful, tranquil. And as women become emotionalistic, very rajistic, then this stirs up the whole entire culture in a rajistic way, an emotionalistic way. And then all this emotionalism, you have a world then that's very, very emotionalistic, which the world is now. Insanely so, actually. So much hatred, so much emotionalism. So much judgmentalism of this and this and that, and polarization and hostility, and you go on and on and on and on and on. And gambling in Vegas, it's the women. You think it's just the men? No way. I mean, the women are ferocious gamblers, just living the high life like, you know, I'm the queen. Get out of my way. Here I am. I am the emotionalized queen. You know, gone is the Victorian women who had the wisdom, cultural wisdom, to build up tranquility and focus. Dharmic, sattvic focus, dharmic focus. That's a rarity these days. It's almost extinct. So the planet becomes hyper-emotionalized. Which is exactly the power source that these cosmic corporate colonialists want. Is they want this world to be like a power source for them of this continuous suffering here. Emotionalization and suffering and fear and pain, you know, and all that emotionalism that comes from all of that, this animalistic emotionalism, which humans can provide a massive amount of when they fall back into, you know, the lower creatureness. Okay, when they fall back into creatureness, and humans become this really tremendous source of emotionalism. Creatures, no animals are as emotionalistic as people are. Okay, humans can become extraordinarily emotionalistic. And we are this way. It's amazing, the people right now, their attitudes. And that's actually a vibratory power source. When we think about wireless right now, right? Wireless this, wireless that. We realize that there's invisible power sources, all right? We can't see the wireless waves and stuff like that, right? But it's there. And of course, electricity seems invisible, right? But it's powering everything. So vibrations of emotionalism may seem invisible to everybody, but it certainly is actually a type of very strong vibration, oscillation. It's a type of oscillation. Electricity is oscillation, isn't it? Basically, right? And so human emotionalism is actually a powerful oscillation that these cosmic corporate colonialists have learned how to capture that, use it, just like we've learned how to capture electricity and store it. They've learned how to capture human emotionalism and store it as a power source. So really, they just want us to be these emotionalized robots. That's their goal for this planet. And they're very far along towards that right now. And the smartphone is helping everyone. They're keeping people constantly emotionalized. Like, and they're thinking, this is what I am. This is what I expect to be. I'm just an emotionalized robot. He. You know, and that's exactly what these invaders really want. This invasive, you know, cosmic corporate colonies are very invasive, and they're trying to stabilize their insanity, really. Just like the colonists here, they want all, you know, pillage these various places and have all their sumptuous homes and sumptuous meals and sumptuous everything and culture. Oh, so sumptuous. But they're trying to stabilize their insanity because they feel that it's very vulnerable. They say the materiality is a way to stabilize it. We got to drug ourselves, you know, with this all this stuff because it feels like it could slip away from us. We could stop hallucinating. You know, wow, this is scary. So it happens throughout the cosmos. You know, it's a hallucination, collective hallucination. So there are these groups, corporations form of say, hey, you know what? You know, if we together, if we form this corporation, you know, we can protect ourselves from stopping our hallucination. And we feel that that will provide, you know, sense of well-being to ourselves, you know, mental well-being. If we just stabilize our hallucination. Of course, it's impossible to stabilize hallucination. The mind can end it at any instant. And the mind is instantaneousness. That's all it is. So there's only instantaneousness. There's no way to stabilize hallucination at all. But these corporations believe that they can do, you know, they're looking for a way to do it. So they gobble up like sharks. They keep gobbling up more and more and more and more and more. Oh, here's another world. Let us, you know, turn that into a plantation of slaves producing this oscillating, you know, emotionalism for us. And they've learned how to use that and store it, actually. Just like we store electricity in all these big transformer, all these plants with electrical plants. And you say, what is it? What's there? Is that a weird metal and stuff? They're storing electricity. I don't understand how they do it, but I know they do it. It's kind of weird. I mean, I have no idea how they do it. Storing electricity is invisible. Has, you know, no weight. Well, how do you store it? Apparently, various capacitors and stuff, they high voltage, they put it into various metals or something that can contain very high voltage pressure, and then capacitors that prevent the voltage from leaking out, apparently. And then they let it out bit by bit through the power lines to power, you know, our electrical stuff. But apparently that there's a ways to set up something that contains a super amount of pressure that really wants to, but it can't get out, you know. It heats it up, though. I would think it would heat it up quite a bit. So they have to, like, so have some way to cool it down. Keep it cool. Transformers, I think, they store high pressure. And then that's given out. There's some way to store electricity. But so it's a tricky science. You have to know how to do it. But once you know how to do it, you can do it. So the same thing with emotional energy. There must be a way for them to store it and prevent it, you know, prevent it from leaking out except when they want to, along some sort of transmission lines, which could be wireless. Just like, you know, we have all this wireless technology now. Well, they probably are able to have this transmission of this emotional energy that they have stored is done wirelessly. Maybe through crystals or something like that, from one crystal to another, but it probably done wirelessly. But they know the technology, there's a whole technology about that, and they certainly know it. And most of us don't understand the technology, how they do it. They call it sorcery or something like that, but they do know how to do it, and just like the third world peoples, that the native peoples where the colonials took them over, they said, what do you want all this stuff for, these resources? What the heck are you doing with all that stuff? We don't have a clue what you're doing with that stuff. Taking all the sap out of the trees? I don't understand what the heck you're doing. Oh, we're making tires. What? You know? Huh? So they were able to, they take all these resources and the people that they didn't know what they were being used for. I still don't understand manufacturing really myself at all. But materialists understand it. They were like frantic after all these resources. The people are scratching their heads saying, what do you need all this stuff for? We use it for like ornamentation or something. But you're like so greedy for all this stuff. Take whatever you want. What's this weird? But they put it through materialistic processes, pressures and chemistry and all these various things to, you know, get some products out of it. Same thing. I mean, we're thinking, what are these people about with our emotionalism? You know, I don't understand that. Well, they certainly understand what they want with it. They're certainly cultivating like a crop. Humans are a crop that these corporate colonialists are growing. Like, right now they're growing these humans. That's why they're telling us you're human. Why? Because they want you to keep reproducing and growing humans so you can produce all this emotionalism for them. It's a cash crop for them. It's something, yeah. It's like us like growing wheat or something, or, you know, growing a forest, planting a lot of trees so a forest so we can cut them down and build houses. I mean, Native Americans would say, what are you doing? What are you cutting these trees down? That's crazy. They didn't build houses. They lived at the forest alone. They had lived in teepees. And so all these people are cutting all the forest down. They're saying, that's crazy. Well, they didn't understand what they're doing with them. And so we don't understand, what are they growing all these humans for? It's crazy. What are they doing with all this emotionalism? And they're cultivating emotionalism in everybody through the television, through movies. It's just intense cultivation. For us, it's to train us, to hypnotize, to train us into generating this constant emotionalism. And we're thinking, why? I mean, what about they doing that? I don't understand it. Well, they understand it. That is for sure. So they have some way of harnessing this emotionalism, storing it as a power source, and using it for all sorts of stuff that they want to use it for. Ultimately, to change reality is what they're using it for. That's their way of trying to change reality, turn humans into this crop of emotionalism. Meaning, forgiveness is taught here, right? Forgiveness, which helps nullify emotionalism. Right religious teachings, spiritual teachings, nullify emotionalism, basically. How to nullify emotionalism. Well, obviously, these corporate colonialists, they don't like that. So that's why they're demonizing religion so much. You know, they don't like it at all. They say, that's interfering with our crop here, folks. We can't have that. So forgiveness, forgive yourself, forgiveness, turn the other cheek. All the virtues help calm down emotionalism in culture. Calm down emotionalism. Reactivity, calm down reactivity. Video games, all this stuff is designed to amp up reactivity. You get constant bombs and attack happening in these video games. React, reactivity. You know, more and more emotionalistic reactivity. So, you know, it's a drug designed to, for the purposes of, it's like a steroid, emotional steroid. Is really the video games are really when we give like cows steroids to produce more milk, like animal steroids, right, to grow pigs to grow fatter, they're giving us electronic steroids to help us grow more emotional, actually. Yeah, these are electronic steroids, emotional steroids. The electronics are emotional steroids, performance enhancing drugs. And the devastating effect on the situation here, on Dharmic culture, devastating. So, the more emotionalized people are, the more they're turned towards war, for sure. And, of course, war benefits, you know, those who are trapping all this emotion, doesn't it? However, it's also a way out, because you can kill the goose to lay the golden egg, so to speak. And then people say, hey, you know, it's enough of that. We don't want to do that anymore. So what they're trying to do is keep us on the edge of war, constantly on the edge of war, without it actually going into a complete meltdown. Because that'll kind of hurt their, you know, productivity. Right. So from that perspective, sometimes having an intense fever, it breaks the illness, it ends the illness. But it's not always necessarily a bad thing. I don't look at it as necessarily a bad thing. Short term it may be, but it may liberate us ultimately from this dreadful situation we're in right now. The collapse of the Dharma in this world. Spiritual materialism taking its place to reassure us, don't worry, you know, you spiritually you're fine. You can just keep going with this culture the way it's going, and spiritually you're fine. You can have your little Zen scroll somewhere in your house, or a little medicine Buddha somewhere, but or whatever. But you're fine, don't worry. You know, just keep going, you know. That's what they say to you. So to bring that to a head, it may you know, when the fever spikes, it's really your immune system getting rid of the virus. Whereas if it's kept at low grade, the virus, just, you know, you stay alive, but you're suffering horribly from this virus. It's devastating you. But if you let your fever reach a point where it spikes, it gets so high, the your body temperature gets so high, the virus can't survive in your body. It kills the virus, and the virus is gone, and if you survive the fever, you recover. So having an intense fever is really a part of the healing from a very severe virus. And we really have a very, very severe viruses in this world, psychological viruses right now. And they want to keep us, you know, ever more automatically addicted to it all. Producing more and more. They're so greedy. You know, like the British Commonwealth, East India Company, one and the same really back then, addicting as many Chinese as possible, many people as possible to opium. Human toil, the toil, you know, and suffering, misery. Just, hey, it's profitable. So they invented this idea that God is a capitalist and God loves profit. So if we're making a profit, God loves us, it's not wrong. It can't be wrong. As long as we're making a profit, we're doing right. Manifest destiny, all this, you know, nonsensical stuff they came up with. And so they just said, you know, it's good. It's God's will that we addict all these people to opium. Because we're making a profit and it's good for us. Good for God. That's good for the ego. Creating misery. They're working for the ego. They weren't working for God. They're calling the ego God. That's what many in the world are doing now. So, however we can get free of this great planetary malaise, you know, is what will happen. We need to get free of it. We want to get free of it. People realize something's really wrong here. Like, just like native peoples of lands, when the colonists came over and took over the infrastructure, they said, at some point they said, you know what? Things aren't going well for us. I mean, our traditional culture is breaking down. They're just turning us into slaves. This isn't working for us. We don't like this. So we have that same feeling on a global scale right now in this world. So many know deep down, says, you know, that things are not trending right. Almost everyone I talk to, especially older people, the boomers, they know that. They say, wow, this something is really, really, really off the rails. We've gone off the rails here really bad. It feels like we're being like sort of, you know, we've been taken over somehow in some way. We're not quite sure how they did it or why they did it or what they, but something isn't right. That is for sure. Something is, you know, really rotten here. Can we go somewhere else? You know, sure. If you expect that you can, piece of cake. But we're trained. These people have trained us. Wants to be slaves. That you can't. You know, how do you train a slave? Is tell them over and over and over, you can't go anywhere. There's nowhere else to go. You know, that you're simply your country is the only country there is. You know, there's, go somewhere. No, you'll fall off the edge of the earth if you do that. So the idea, we're not talking about vacation all the time. We're talking about actually relocating somewhere. So the people, they say, no, there's nowhere else to relocate. You know, it's if you go past this border, you'll fall off the edge of the earth into hell. And people say, oh my God. So they feel that they can't. Their expectations are they can't do it. They're trained to believe they can't. It's like, I think some animals are trained. Donkeys or was it camels and stuff, horses. You can train them, like draw a line or something or whatever. You put a rope somewhere, whatever. They think they can't move. They can't. I said, we can't go anywhere. We're stuck here, and like that. So humans can be trained that they're stuck here in this quote unquote world. There's nowhere else they can go. But that just serves the interest of those who want to enslave you here. Okay, turn you into slaves to their plantation and producing emotionalism. Whereas if you really expect that you absolutely I can go anywhere, piece of cake. My mind decides I'm going to be somewhere else. I'm going to be focused somewhere else. I'm focused somewhere else. That's how I see it. We should be able to just like that, relocate just like that. One moment, one instant, we're here in this world. Next instant, like that, we're in some other place where there's not all this world war taking place. Yeah, it's certainly I see how that would be. Super easy if our expectations were aligned in that direction. If our expectations are aligned that it's impossible, of course we're going to get into our mind and thinking instead of doing it. But I've always said, of course it's possible. Should be easy. Of course it's possible. Should be very easy. But most people ridicule you. You say, no, it's crazy. You're crazy. We're stuck here. It's the only place we got here. Don't over. It's the only world we got. You know, we're stuck here. Well, that's a nice little slave mentality to have, isn't it? Very nice little slave mentality to have. And that's cultivated here by those who want to use your emotionalism, you know, to empower their feeling that they can stabilize hallucination. Because they're getting real bored of hallucination, so they're desperate to stabilize it. When you get real bored, you go one of two directions. You can go to the dark side or the light side. You can go to the Dharmic side or the anti-Dharmic side. And if you go to the Dharmic side, you go into Dharmic, you know, practice of realization. If you go to the dark side, you go into trying to get all this power to create effects that you want, which make you keep believing that there's a way to alter reality, so you don't have to drop your pretense that you can be asleep. It's because people think that's an abyss. They don't expect it, so it frightens them very badly. So they go into just trying to get all this power to alter stuff. Some of them go into big alteration things. They get this emotionalized energy. Maybe they can collapse all sorts of grids, you know, of different types of grids. Planetary grids, cosmic grids, there are all sorts of subtle realms are vast. And they collect a human emotionalism to have power in these subtler realms. And they may be able to, you know, demolish huge areas and to say, look, I can create massive change in this area, which reassures them that they feel that they can ultimately find a way to create change in reality. But of course, reality being the instantness of an intrinsic spaciousness, in complete intrinsicness, the instant intrinsicness of all there is, holiness, holy intrinsic instantness, can't be changed at all. So they're just, you know, on a dead end, to say the least. But there's certainly those who go in that direction. They get desperate. They say, wow, if I don't find a way to change reality, I'm going to give up. And then I feel that I'll be annihilated if I do that, right? So they're anti-Dharmic. They don't have the perspective of continuity fear, that if they, anyone of them can repent at any moment. Keep that in mind. As soon as you see continuity fear is the problem, you repent, and you're no longer interested in that nonsense, trying to gain power like that. You say, oh, the only problem is my expectations, and if they're not met, I'm not sure how to function. So it momentarily shocks me and scares me, and that can panic me. But as long as I'm aware of this dynamic, I can work on that and block panic, then I can gradually reshape my expectations. See? So I can expect now that it's impossible to change reality. And that becomes all my expectations. And then there's no shock and no panic. And I can drop my pretense that it's possible to be have an absence of awakeness. And glory then. I'm free of all misery. Totally. So ultimately, everyone has to repent that way. The way to repent is to recognize the effect that your expectations have upon your mind. So even though it's a dead end, the negative path, the dark path, a dead end, you have to come out of that dead end. You got no choice. It's just modifying a dream never equates to modifying reality. And you get really bored and tired of constantly trying to modify a dream because it never gives you what you want. It's really just an attempt to induce a change in reality. That's what we're looking for. And it never happens. The change in reality never happens. So we get really, really fed up with this whole nonsense here. Really. And then you go get cast one of two directions from that. And going the Dharmic direction does take a lot of humility and a lot of willingness. Willing to be very lowly and all that. Whereas those who aren't willing to do that, they say, no, I got to stay large and in charge and powerful. And I just, you know, that scares me too much. I don't want to have that Cinderella life. And so they then go into trying to, you know, create powerful changes. And that leads you down into a very wicked, wicked path, to say the least. You ultimately start enslaving, trying to enslave more and more and more. And get more and more addicted. Get everyone else addicted to, you know, to produce the emotionalism you're looking for. Ultimately, produce the energy you want to create these transformations in the subtle realms. Or in this realm, too. I mean, but that's just sort of gross stuff. The clever ones are into the subtle realms and creating, try to create changes in the subtle realms because they feel that's more like trying to change reality. They liken these subtle realms to be more closer to reality. So making changes there, they think it is more effective, or at least working there to make changes to induce a change in reality is more effective than doing it here in this more gross physical realm. So the heavyweight dark forces are in the subtler realms, trying to bring about massive changes there, inducing massive destructions and things like that, and plagues and sicknesses and everything, which the dream hope is that would induce a change in reality. Of course, it doesn't do anything to reality. So they're just wasting their time. They'll repent. They have no choice. Don't worry about their repentance. Just worry about your own. Focus on your own. And the vast changes they're trying to make in the subtler realms spill over into this realm too. They affect this realm too. So that's what's been happening with all this technology and all this stuff is that's more subtler technology used in subtler realms is coming in the physical realm now, so you can make massive attempts to invoke change in reality. One of them would be to set up a technological world totally dependent on it, and then have all this EMP devices detonated, nuclear blasts in the atmosphere to bring about a collapse of the infrastructure and starve everybody, you know, cause this massive, you know, horrible scenario here, and thinking that that will induce change in reality. But if people just relocate, no emotionalism. So they don't get what they're looking for there. So they tell everybody, you can't relocate, it's impossible. Of course they're going to say that. They don't want you to. They don't want you to. They want you to feel trapped. You're trapped here. And to go through all this devastating emotional trauma, which they feel that'll help them have more power to try to induce a change in reality. That's how it goes. So they don't like the saints. The saints keep everybody calm and peaceful. Stay away. That's mythological stuff. That's in the past. We're more sophisticated than that, everybody. Come on. Let's watch the television. Watch these, Tyrannosaurus Rexes rampaging through everywhere. Everybody's screaming and getting eaten and everything. Yeah, that's what you should be doing. Shouldn't be paying attention to the saints. Come on. That's archaic stuff. That's like, that's uneducated stuff. didn't get an education. If you did that kind of stuff. You're some sort of backwoods cracker, you know? Come on. Get hooked to the TV. We'll show you all sorts of scary stuff. That's sophisticated. It's exactly what the modern culture is saying. Exactly what they're saying. And they're saying, you gotta die, you gotta die, you're here to die, you gotta die. No, maybe I'll just relocate. No, you can't do that, you're here to die, you're here to die. I said, I don't understand anything, so I don't understand dying either. I don't understand anything. The eye doesn't understand anything. The eye doesn't have to relocate. Spirit can relocate its attention. And that's not done through understanding. It's done through desire, volition of spirit, decision. It's done through decision. But of course, the fear of our expectations does have to be, those have to be worked on. Yeah. Okay, how are we doing here? We're sailing along on a nice long one. But what do people, are people watching? They have the time to watch? No, they're too busy. They're too busy traveling. They're too busy doing whatever they do. I had to work today. I don't like to work on weekends because you want to make sure you have time to take it easy. And of course, the scientists are all telling us, don't worry, just keep going down the path we're going down. You'll be able to like have all this leisure time. Well, that's exactly what they told my generation growing up. That's the lie that we were told. We have way less leisure now than before. We're like slaves right now. Way less relaxation. Oh, the pace of life now is horrible compared to what it used to be. They've created a dystopia, the scientists. Of course, all the while they told us, you're going to live the life of luxury and ease. Don't worry. Just go along with it. Just let us, support us, fund us. You know, support us, fund us. And you will see how wonderful it will be. Well, it's become a nightmare is what it says. So no more funding for science. Okay, cut it off. Start the process of going back to a Dharmic culture. No more research funds for science, this, that. Why give the money to those who have created all the problems in the first place, you know? They have no blueprint whatsoever for how to really solve the problems, which is going back, changing your attitude. No, they're just producing more and more fear, actually, in everyone. Amplifying it, giving an ability to amplify through all the smartphones and televisions and everything that everybody's glued to all the time, to amplify emotionalism. That's all they're geared towards. You know, the media is just an emotional amplifier, an amplifier for emotionalism now. False media stories, false this, clickbait this. You know, all the headlines are so, they go to the internet, it's like most of the headlines are lies. You click, it's a lie. They just have this emotional clickbait for you, you know. It's amazing what's happened here. It's an addiction. This is not Dharmic culture at all here right now. And Dharmic culture is the only culture that actually works. So scientific culture simply doesn't work. End of story. Stop funding it. And of course they say, well, we're curing cancer. They've been saying that for ages, haven't they? And they always say, you know, we're protecting the children and curing cancer. You know, so give us all your money. Fund us as we create this, you know, hellish plantation for you. Absolutely. Consider defunding science. It's time. You know, it's science that the modern weaponry has, they've made all this stuff, right? All the ammunitions, the weapons, the systems to bring about, you know, catastrophic collapse of this world. It's science that's done that, not the saints. It's easy to sit still, isn't it? You don't need science to sit still. Oh, we need the science of sitting still. No, you don't. You just sit on a bench. Sit on a bench with a nice cushion. Just, right? Just read, consider. You could watch your mind. Be aware of your mind. Hear truth. Get used to hearing truth. Expect to hear truth. Expect to have truth arise within you. It's all about working on your expectations. You don't need technology to do that. Anyone can do that. Every minute of the day is to reshape your expectations. That's something that's done as a mental, what you do with your mind. You always have your mind with you. You don't need technology to have your mind with you. You don't need science to have your mind with you. They want to think that you do. They say you don't have a mind until science gives it to you. That's what they're telling you. You have to get educated. You don't have a mind unless you're educated. And, of course, corporations set up the whole educational system, and the science has set it up also. So they're just programming you how to be a robotic slave. And they're telling you that they gave you your mind. You know, they're the ones that shaped your mind. You didn't have a mind until we shaped it. It was just a blank rock, and we shaped the rock in this beautiful sculpture. And it's not true. Science didn't give you a mind. God created you as mind. Not as a body with a mind. You are mind. We are mind. God is the one mind. There's only the one mind. That's always with us. The one mind is already awake. It's always been awake to allness. And it's perfect. It's perfectly informed. The one mind. Perfectly created, perfectly informed. Already is that. Always has been that. We just have to gently give up the perspective that it's otherwise. That's it. So the wisdom is already within all of us. The awakeness is always already within all of us. The one mind is already within all of us. We don't need science to give us that at all. Science doesn't bestow that upon us, not in the slightest bit. But people, they're taught that now. You're really taught that somehow, you know, your teachers give you your mind. It, your mom, your parents give you your mind. Nobody gave us a mind. We are mind. We can't ever be other than mind. There's no way anyone can give us mind. It's impossible. But if you think someone external to you has given you mind, then they can take it away. And so you really become a slave. They'll threaten you to take it away if you don't do what they say. That's the educational system. This world has been planned to produce this dialectica problem of that you think your mind is somehow outside of you, and you only have access to it if these people agree that you have access to it. But in order to have access, you have to do what they tell you to do. That's massive slavery, isn't it? That's the very definition of slavery. Relocation, if we decide, is instantaneous. 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 You just said, I practiced this a couple of days ago, maybe yesterday. I just felt like, oh yeah, I can do that. It's just, you realize you're just now in this other realm. You're there, and it's just like, okay, that was easy. I thought it was going to be difficult. If it's not difficult, where's the fear? It's like, oh, yeah, that's simple to do that, isn't it? Wow, so easy. It's like a dimensional shift. You can make a dimensional shift. Technically, of course, in reality, there's no such thing as dimensions, but we are working on setting down the belief. And as long as we're reshaping our expectations, we work within the parameters of the dream to some extent, right? So within the dream, there's certainly different dimensions. Within our dreaming, there's certainly many layers and levels and dimensions, etc. So we can certainly shift our attention there if we want to. So this is all just helping you and me change our expectations, right? Reshape them, I say. Reshape them. Keep it remodel. Reshape our expectations. No one can give you a mind. You are mind. Everything is mind. No one can bestow mind upon anyone. It's totally impossible. So access your mind directly. Access your mind directly, and you can do that anywhere, always, right? There's never incapacity to access your mind. There might be some dimension where the lies about, you know, that you can't do it are less. Here the lies are so extreme, but people so believe their mind is, you know, so much outside of them, they have to have access to it. The belief is so strong here, and the program is so terrible here, that it's easy that we get sucked into that. So you should go to a place where there's hardly any of that. So you wouldn't get sucked into it, and it's much easier to then access your mind, because you realize, oh, I have my mind. I can't not have it. It's impossible not to have it. I don't need to jump through any hoops to get it from anyone, right? So it would make it a lot easier. Not that you can't do it here right now. You certainly can, because the mind is with you always. You are the mind. So, you know, we'll see. We keep reshaping our expectations. Keep getting clearer, 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 and all of this. War could happen in the world. Again, those dark, really dark forces, they may not want it. They like limited wars. Okay, there's a constant concern that it might get worse. But they want to make sure you see, yeah, it could be really bad. So if you don't emotionalize yourselves, you know, then it could become worse. They say, want everybody worried. So they want a number of limited wars keep going, but they probably don't want it to become an all-out nuclear conflagration, actually, because that would cut off their, you know, their cash crop, their power supply, so to speak. So they're trying to keep, you know, have these limited wars, keep everybody in a state of emotionalism, and prevent it from becoming a world war. But it, you know, the problem is a very tricky line they're on, because the more emotionalized you make everyone, the more likely they are going to jump into a world war. So, you know, it's a very insecure situation they're in. And, you know, world war could just erupt just like that. Just like that. So they're sort of on a dilemma. They've got to keep everyone on the brink of war without it erupting into a world war. But what I've seen is a world war is going to take place. That's certainly what I have been shown. And again, it may even come from people deciding, you know what, we don't want to be put into a position of perpetual enslavement, mental enslavement like this, and we want this fever to be hot enough that it really melts down the illness, and we want to start over again with a Dharmic culture. So that may be come about from that. People just said, you know, it's better to have this physical war that melts down the whole thing and restart, start over again, than to just continue on down this road of just being milked ceaselessly for our, you know, hideous mental illnesses, you know. It they've had enough of that. So, you know, it's who's to say we're just bringing this up as a possibility. Not that a World War III would be fun by any means. I mean, going through the fever spiking is not any fun at all. It's terrible. But it's terrible in the short term. Long term, the virus is no more, and you recover. So, again, just food for consideration here. Food for our expectations. So we feel we have some flexibility in our considerations. Very great. Full stop in the wow.